Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, the interim director of Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to a very special evening, and also to say how pleased I am to see Jennifer Rabb, our wonderful president here, who made Roosevelt House possible. Jennifer, always wonderful to have you here. Many of you have been here before to enjoy book discussions like Ira Katznelson's Fear Itself, or hear world leaders like the former ICC prosecutor Luis Moreno Ocampo, or talk presidential politics during our conference on Ike Reconsidered, Lessons from the Eisenhower Legacy for the 21st Century. But tonight is different. I've long wanted to have a series of conversations with the most interesting people I know personally as friends. Ed Koch was my first guest, followed by MoMA President Agnes Gund, Jim Lipton of Inside the Actors Studio, Vartan Gregorian of the Carnegie Foundation, Harvard Professor Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot, and most recently, Judy Collins. My guest tonight is a very good friend, Joseph Califano, who is an active member of our Roosevelt House board and was the driving force behind the very successful conference on Lyndon Johnson's domestic presidency that we had 2 years ago. When he was appointed HEW secretary by Jimmy Carter, he asked two friends, Kingman Brewster and McGeorge Bundy of the Ford Foundation, Kingman was president of Yale, to loan him people to assist in recruiting staff for HEW, and I was the choice from Yale. And so we worked together for a few months. I was searching for jobs like the director of the Center for Disease Control and the assistant secretary for health and others. I learned a lot from that tour of duty, Joe, and it was a privilege to watch how you blended principled policies with practical politics for the benefit of both the president and the nation. An enduring lesson for me. And we reconnected when I was president of the New School, whose remarkable chair, Dorothy Hershon, was the mother of Joe's wife, Hillary. Hillary and Joe have been our dear friends, both here in New York and in Connecticut, where we both live ever since. And in between my work for Joe at HEW and our reconnection in New York through Hillary, I was teaching 20th century American history at the University of Chicago, and the very best book on how government works was Joe's The Triumph and Tragedy of Lyndon Johnson, which I assigned to my class. Somehow in this very busy life, he's found time to author a dozen books, including a memoir, Inside, A Public and Private Life, A Presidential Nation, America's Healthcare Revolution, Who Lives, Who Dies, Who Pays, as well as that wonderful book on Lyndon Johnson. So some of my questions tonight will be drawn from these books. But as background for our conversation, we're going to show you a brief video describing a remarkable life. And after the video, Joe and I will have a conversation here for about 40 minutes, and then we're going to open it up to your questions, and we'll be done by 7:20. So let the video roll.
He's been called a whiz kid, deputy president, Mr. Secretary, and chairman and founder. He's lived life on the inside, from the corridors of the Pentagon to the hallways of the White House, where he walked with presidents. A man of faith whose courage and dedication continues to shape American history and policy. Joseph A. Califano, Jr. On May 15, 1931, in Depression-era Brooklyn, Joe Califano is born, the only child of Catherine and Joseph Anthony Califano. It's on these streets where he grows up, playing punch ball and studying at his neighborhood Catholic school. Joe's father would say, "You are the only child God gave us, and he gave us a good one." His parents would encourage a passion for learning, a strong work ethic, and a deeply rooted commitment to faith and helping his fellow man. College is Holy Cross, and then Joe attends Harvard Law School, where he edits the Law Review, graduates magna cum laude, and discovers his enduring love of the law. After serving in the Navy as counsel for the Judge Advocate General, Joe heads back to New York to practice law. But quickly, he feels compelled to do more.
Everyone is voting for Jack.
As the decade turns, Joe reads a book that changes his life.
This generation of Americans has a rendezvous with destiny.
Kennedy's faith and dedication to the underprivileged resonates with Joe. So he jumps at the chance to campaign for the young candidate in New York. Joe answers the call to be part of the new frontier. He writes Cyrus Vance at the Department of Defense, and within a week is working in Washington. Joe becomes one of McNamara's whiz kids. As tensions rise with the Cold War and Castro, waves of change are sweeping the nation.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time.
As America mourns, the presidency passes on. Joe stays in Washington as general counsel to the Army. As McNamara's top troubleshooter, Joe's success does not go unnoticed. In the summer of 65, he is summoned to the White House to serve under a man who will have the greatest impact on his life, Lyndon B. Johnson.
Come gather round, people, wherever you roam.
The great society rests on abundance and liberty for all. It demands an end to poverty and racial injustice.
Against the backdrop of the turmoil of the 60s as LBJ's top domestic aide, Joe works tirelessly to realize Johnson's great society. This is his chance to bring about the social justice he believes in. Their bond is a close one. Johnson would say, "When Joe speaks, it's my voice you should hear." From civil rights to the war on poverty, Joe works side by side with Johnson on policy that would change the fabric of America. When LBJ leaves office, Joe would start a new chapter in his life, but he would always remember what President Johnson told him the day they spotted a homeless man on the street.
President Johnson turned to me, and he held his thumb and his forefinger together like that, and he said, "As long as you work for me, don't ever forget that the difference between him and me and him and you is that much."
It was a lesson Joe took to heart. As a Washington lawyer in the 70s, Joe keeps his close ties to government. He advises the Democratic National Committee during its tumultuous convention. He defends the Washington Post's First Amendment rights, and he would find himself representing both the DNC and the Post during one of the most seminal moments in American history.
Five men apparently caught in the act of burglarizing and bugging Democratic headquarters in Washington.
Within days of the Watergate break-in, Joe files a landmark suit against the committee to re-elect the president. In the months that follow, he fights to protect the right to free speech and the sanctity of the Washington Post sources.
"I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow."
"It is a privilege to be nominated by President-elect Carter to be Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare."
Joe is called into public service again.
"I'm very happy."
As secretary, he channels the energy and determination he learned from LBJ. Within months, Joe proposes wide-reaching reforms that touch almost every segment of American life.
"I am today announcing a fundamental restructuring of the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare."
Child immunization, commissioning the first Surgeon General's report on health promotion and disease prevention, controlling health care costs, ending the definition of homosexuality as a mental disease. women's athletics, and Title IX, the dangers of asbestos, targeting Medicare and Medicaid fraud, the problem of obesity. Issues that are relevant to this day are spearheaded on his watch. And Joe fearlessly takes on the biggest battle of all.
Cigarette smoking is public health enemy number one in the United States of America.
Joe takes on big tobacco.
People who smoke are committing slow motion suicide.
And big tobacco takes on Joe. A storm of controversy surrounds Secretary Califano.
Joseph Califano is out as ATW Secretary.
I have no regrets.
Throughout the years, Joe has not slowed down. From radio and television to his many books, Joe continues to spread the word. His energy and enthusiasm for the work is an inspiration. Joseph A. Califano, Jr., visionary, innovator, activist, loving husband, proud father of five, and grandfather of eight. A life's work that proves that with courage, commitment, and the power of faith, one man can truly make a difference.
I can't possibly live up to that, and it's inaccurate in more than one respect, the most important of which is there are now 9 grandchildren, not 8.
Yeah. Well, it is a hard act to follow, but let me try. Going back to your memoir, you said your father teased your mother by saying nice things about Eleanor Roosevelt, but was circumspect about politics more generally. What did you think of the Roosevelts growing up? And tell us a little bit about your parents.
Well, my mother was a public school teacher for 42 years in Brooklyn. My father was a secretary and administrative assistant at IBM when there were 1,200 employees at IBM, I think, when he went to work for them. My mother couldn't stand Eleanor Roosevelt. She loved Westbrook Pegler, if any of you remember Westbrook Pegler. But I think my parents, were deeply religious. My guess is they voted for Roosevelt the first 2 times, and then didn't vote for a Democrat again until Kennedy ran. I took my father to Jimmy Carter's convention in Madison Square Garden. And we're sitting there, and President Carter, not then president, candidate, talks about Italians. And my father grabbed the arms of that chair, and I knew he never got Carter. Carter never got his vote. Go ahead.
So going back to your childhood, when you entered Holy Cross, the index of forbidden books included works by Hemingway, O'Hara, Mark Twain. But you said the index did not stop me from reading in the privacy of my room, often between brown paper covers, just about everything by contemporary writers. So what books, going back to those early years, left a lasting influence on you? And what do you like to read now?
I think Hemingway's books did. I think William Faulkner. But mostly F. Scott Fitzgerald. I ended up writing my senior thesis on him to give you a sense of what Holy Cross was like in those days. I had to get special permission to write my senior thesis on F. Scott Fitzgerald. I think that probably had a big impact on me, all of his books. Today, more nonfiction and murder mysteries. I love murder mysteries.
You write fondly of your time at the Harvard Law School. You said, if Holy Cross had gotten me to think about the grand philosophical questions, Harvard Law School started me thinking about public policy and politics. Who were some of the professors at Harvard who influenced you?
Actually, the two greatest professors I ever had were, one was Paul Freund, who taught constitutional law, and I also taught conflicts of law. He was a fantastic professor. And in at Holy Cross, there was a professor named Father Bean, who taught rhetoric and English literature and a few things like that. They were the two greatest professors I had in my life. It was an array of stars at Harvard. I mean, C.V., who was the great torts professor, and a guy named Fuller, who was the great contracts professor. They had written the casebooks that were being used all over the country. So it was an extraordinary education.
Did you ever study with Kingman Brewster?
I did. My God, I forgot all about it. John, especially with you here. Kingman Brewster did a seminar on antitrust mostly on price maintenance. And I guess I wrote my thesis at Harvard on price maintenance. But I took Kingman Brewster's seminar on antitrust. He was very good. It was interesting. I mean, you know, at Holy Cross, there was a fundamental, real sense of social justice. And remember, we're talking about 1948 to 1952, and a tremendous sense of racial inequality and how that violated social justice. But fundamentally, from a sort of natural law, Christian theology point of view, and then to go to Harvard Law School and see those same values, really from a much more political in many ways point of view. One fit right into the other.
Who were some of your political heroes and heroines? Who were some of the important mentors that you've had?
You know, I don't think Kennedy was the first real political hero I had. I mean, I read Schlesinger's books, and I read one of Roosevelt's speechwriters wrote two terrific books about him. I can't remember his name. I read a lot about Roosevelt, but I think Kennedy, and that's what drew me to Washington.
And before Kennedy, I guess you liked Ike.
I did like Ike. I voted for Eisenhower in 1952 and 1956, and I had an uncle who was a big-time Republican. I mean, it was a really big deal for the family because I remember he gave the Republicans a $100 contribution. And I have framed in our house in Connecticut a certificate that my Uncle Joe Gill got for making such a major contribution, allegedly signed by Eisenhower. I did, and then switched over.
You know, when I asked myself in preparing for this, how would I describe Joe's political philosophy? On the one hand, he's identified with LBJ and the Great Society and big government. On the other hand, he cares deeply and talks about personal responsibility. He has served on the boards of private sector companies like CBS and Chrysler. So it's a mix, and I couldn't find the right words. How would you describe your political philosophy?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I think I really, it really is driven by a sense of social justice. I think from the time of Kennedy, I had a real sense of, you know, poverty amidst wealth. Lyndon Johnson really drove that home, because he talked about it all the time. And I think on the foreign side, I think I was like most Italian-American and Irish-American Catholics in those days, very anti-communist, very strongly anti-communist. And my parents were, all my friends were. The McCarthy thing started to really sour me, and I was at Harvard Law School at the time of those hearings. I vividly remember them, though. I think the other thing was a real sense of the impact of discrimination. I mean, I can remember to this day going to the dining room at Harvard Law School and getting the newspaper when Brown v. Board of Education was decided, and it was like cheering. It was like something great had really happened. But on the practical side, I mean, on the other side, I mean, this country wouldn't be what it is without large corporations and without the things that they've done and the things we've discovered, our people have discovered.
In your autobiography, you have a chapter that's entitled Born, Bred, and Branded Catholic, which concludes, "My parents reared me to be an American and a Catholic. America promised me opportunity and Catholicism salvation." Talk to us a little bit about how religion has been a strength for you over the years, and what challenges did you face where you really had to draw deep down on your religion to get through?
I went to Catholic schools all the way through Holy Cross. I went to a Catholic elementary school, a Jesuit high school called Brooklyn Prep that doesn't exist anymore today, tragically, also educated John Sexton. And then Holy Cross. Very, very committed to Catholic doctrine. The Jesuits, of course, always with a hefty dose of what I would call social justice, but I'd also call always pushing the edge of the envelope. When I saw it in public life, I mean, you know, Lyndon Johnson was a major way committed to family planning. I mean, he accepted the first president or political leader of that stature to accept the Margaret Sanger Award. He wouldn't give wheat to India unless the Indians had a family planning program. And all hell broke loose from the Catholic bishops in the course of this. He said, you know, we got to make peace with the Catholic bishops. And he said, because the day is going to come in this country when the only people that will be on our side are the Negroes and the Catholic bishops. And with all these programs we've got. And so I went, there was a priest named Frank Hurley, who was the lobbyist for the Catholics. Sat down with him and we, you know, how do we deal with this? And to understand the difference of today and then, I mean, they were a major lobbying force for us in Washington. We used them a lot. And we came to a kind of agreement that if Johnson would stop talking about birth control and talk about the population problem, which allowed for feeding people and other things, then bishops would cool off the attack. So I come back, very proudly tell the president, I think I've worked this out with Frank Hurley, and he said, we really got to nail this down. And he said, I want you to meet with Dearden. Dearden was the head of the Catholic bishops. So I go out to meet, think of this in the context of trying to do anything like this today. I went out and met with Bishop Dearden. He didn't sign any paper, but he basically agreed to this. And Johnson started talking about population control, and the bishop stopped criticizing him. A document arrives at the White House from Dean Rusk to Rostow, really, and basically it was several nations had signed an agreement to do something about birth control. And those were the words in this document. And the president sends it to me, and tells Rostow to give it to me and get my okay. And Rostow wonders what the hell he's asking me that for. I look at it. I talk to the president. He said, we'll change it. And we changed it to population problem and got these four or five nations that had already signed it to sign up. They probably never knew why the change was made.
Let me move on to the to your first public service that was shown here. Wonderful picture of you and Cy Vance. May I ask you about Cy Vance and Bob McNamara, both of whom I knew. When you worked for Cy, you got a call for a more demanding job in the Pentagon, and you wrote in your autobiography that Cy Vance told you, "You're as bright a young lawyer as I've come across." but you need more experience before taking a job like this. Bob can be headstrong, and I'm not sure you're yet seasoned enough to argue with him or for him to listen to you. And that's essential for the good of the department. What was that about?
I was Cy Vance's special assistant. He was general counsel of the Defense Department. McNamara was going to name him Secretary of the Army. And Cy called me into his office and said, McNamara's going to offer you the job of general counsel of the Defense Department. But I don't think you're ready yet. And he said, I don't think he's headstrong. I don't think you've got enough whatever to really argue with him. And I think this is a politically treacherous field, this whole Pentagon and the Defense Department. And I think you need more experience. But it's up to you. And I said, what happens if I don't, if I don't take the job, if I don't take the job? And he said, if you don't take the job, you come with me. And I'll make you my special assistant. You'll learn about how to run a department. Learn about non-legal stuff. So I slept on it very hard. And boy, it was tempting. And I didn't take the job. I thought, incidentally, Cy Vance had as much integrity as anybody I ever worked with in the government. And then actually within a few months, the general counsel of the Army left. And Cy made me general counsel of the Army as well as his assistant to work on a variety of things, some wholesome, some not so wholesome.
And then eventually you went over to work for McNamara, I guess, and you said, I learned immediately that rapid action was typical of McNamara, who repeatedly warned, not deciding is a decision. Let's all remember that when we decide not to do something. So looking back on your time with McNamara, what did you learn from that experience? And talk to us a little bit about you and him and the war and what your views were about the war at that time.
He was a phenomenal manager, whatever. Think about going before you get to the war. I mean, he really ran the Pentagon. He would say, we're going to decide whether to have a defense intelligence agency or whether we put all intelligence in the Air Force or whether we put it here and give it to the services. You've got 30 days to come back and comment on the alternatives. The first time he did something like that, a couple of the services said they couldn't do it in that time. He said, fine, we'll make the decision. He made the decision, and he was, in that sense, incredible. He was brilliant. Intellectually. I mean, my most memorable example, you may recall the supersonic transport. We didn't, the British and French were going to the supersonic transport. I think probably President Johnson didn't want to go for it. I don't know at that time, but he named McNamara chairman of a group to look at it. McNamara called me in through this paper because you're going to be the executive director. You're going to run this. Going to create a blue team for it, a red team against. We decided not to build the supersonic transport, but in the course of doing that, I had this vast study of the jumbo jet and what it would cost, how it would compete, and oil. And he said he used to take these things home at night, read them at midnight and 1 a.m., and he went down these. It came in the next morning, 7:30 or whatever, and he was running his fingers down these columns for gasoline and oil. He said, what did you use as an inflation factor? You must have used less than 5%. I said, yeah, we used 4%. I was stunned. He said, you got to use 6%. It's not realistic. I mean, he was things like that. On the war, I think he was the biggest hawk in the administration. There's no question about that. I think in all candor, if I had never gone to the White House, I probably would have been supporting what he was doing. The day after Johnson was elected in 64, I was still working for Bob, and he went down to the ranch with three or four alternatives for buildup of various kinds. This mining, Haiphong Harbor, a variety of things. And everybody expected that Johnson would make a decision. And because Johnson had said he wouldn't make a decision while in the campaign, in the heat of the campaign, and to McNamara's surprise, he said, no decision. I'm sending Bundy to Vietnam. And Bundy came back from Vietnam, and then he sent Bob to Vietnam. Bob committed, finally, was the biggest proponent of the buildup. There were only two people against it, incidentally, Clark Clifford, who was outside the government, and George Ball, who was Under Secretary of State. Everybody else, it was totally for it. I think Bob never got over the war. I think it devastated him. When he left in 68, he used to say he didn't know whether he quit or was fired. But Johnson used to say, but then I was working for him, he said, McNamara can't handle this being called McNamara's war. It's destroying him. And it's got to be my war. I'm the person that is pursuing it. We got to stop and don't let anybody call it McNamara's war. I think Bob never recovered. Later on in life, I'd go down and have dinner with him. Occasionally he'd show me a little clipping saying, look, did you see this? The great historian Kennedy, I forget his first name, had done a long book on this. You know, he pointed out that everybody was thinking of dominoes, and there were no disagreement about that. And he never forgave himself. I don't think the book, incidentally, that he wrote was an honest book in the sense that he said he thought the war was unwinnable and immoral. From the beginning, if he had thought that, he would be one of the most awful people ever, I think. In fact, it wasn't until October of 67 when he really started to have profound doubts about the war and indicate that. On religion, I should mention, this is a wonderful, McNamara, late in life, when he was about 80 plus, married a wonderful Italian woman, and he called me up and he said, I want you to know I'm going to get married. I said, God, fantastic. He said, I really don't want to, but she's a good Catholic and she wouldn't live with me unless I marry her. And he said, I want you to know I did all the pre-marriage stuff, all the pre-Cana stuff with the apostolic delegate. I said, fantastic. And he said, at the end of it, he turned to me and he said, Mr. McNamara, you have to raise the children in the Catholic faith.
Let's move on to the White House. How did Johnson pick you for the White House job, and what surprised you when you got to the White House? What was different from what you'd imagined?
I didn't know him. I mean, strange as that may seem to you, I knew Valenti, I knew Moyers, I knew Bundy, I knew the people over there because I when I was working for McNamara, he was a shrewd bureaucrat, and everything from the White House had to come through his office, which meant it all came through me, so I had gotten to know them. They first offered me a job. Moyers and Bundy said the president wanted me to come over the day after the election in 64 and work on Latin America and work on recruiting for the new administration. And then I said, I have to tell Bob, and they said, wait till the president calls. I said, no, I'm going back to have lunch with him. I've got to tell him. So I told McNamara that. He said, out of the question. He said, there are only two jobs over here that are more important than what you're doing now over in the White House. One is Bundy's, and one is if the president would create a domestic advisor, policy advisor. Hmm. And he said, I'll take care of it. And a couple of days later, he said to me, it's done, president, going to go somewhere else. But he said, I'm worried that we just whet his appetite. And about 6 months later, Jack Valenti called me and he said, the president wants you to come over and be his domestic policy person. He wants you to do the legislative program. Remember, I've only been to the Pentagon. The domestic program and be sort of a utility infielder. So I said, well, I got to talk to McNamara. And Valenti says, this president doesn't make the same mistake twice. He's talked to McNamara. So I went in to talk to McNamara, and McNamara says, that's not enough. It's going to be a terrible problem with Vietnam and the Great Society. You've got to coordinate economic policy. to understand, I'm 33 or 34 years old. He said, I'll take care of it. So I go back to my office, and McNamara, later that day, calls me in, and he says, it's done. I said, my God, what a job. He said, no, it's not even a job. It's not a job description. It's a chance. If you don't deliver, it's over, believe me. So I went over there, and I shook his hand. He was having all the Ken Galbraith and a whole array of advisors, outside advisors. We use them all the time, I learned. And he introduced me as on his staff. I still hadn't even shaken his hand. And then I shook his hand, and we were off to the races. I think I was fortunate because there were three or four crises right at the very beginning, and which I was charged with dealing with, and I was fortunate enough that they worked out.
Shortly after your appointment, you spent a weekend at the ranch. Think back. In your memoir, you said he was a man-eater, willing to use his staff up in his drive to be the education president, the environmental president, the health president, the housing president, the consumer president, the anti-crime president, and most of all, the anti-poverty and civil rights president. So I ask, what were your intuitions about LBJ as a person from that first visit to the ranch? And was the Great Society a coherent vision? Or did it just sort of evolve?
No. Well, the second question for him was clearly a coherent vision. There was the concept was a hand up, not a hand out. There were several things going on. You have to, for those of you who were really thinking about those days, it wasn't just the civil rights problem and it wasn't just the poverty problem. The country was changing dramatically. The small banks were being taken over by the large banks. There wasn't a corner grocer there. You know, there were no supermarkets when I was a kid in Brooklyn. There, the supermarkets were coming in. There were these vast, large corporate enterprises. And there were enormously large and powerful unions. And so the other thing that was going on at that time was that change in the country, in a sense that you got to give, we talk about the middle class today, but he would talk about it in terms of, you know, the housewife goes into a grocery store and the can is designed by the brightest designers and the smartest accountants and lawyers, and that's who she's competing with. Or a veteran can't borrow money, has to go borrow money. He's a pawn in the hands of the banks. He was full of that. So we had all of that as well. In terms of what he was like, he was all consuming. I mean, I don't know, some of you, you know, one, the first week I was there, so the phone rings at 8:00 in the morning, and I had the only office on the same floor as his, which had a bathroom, and this huge office, now about four offices over there now. And he gets on the phone with my secretary, he's in the bathroom, isn't there a phone in there? He says, no. He says, put a phone in there. So I come out, we have to understand we had a hotline, Johnson had a hotline, it just rang. Didn't ring on and off like a regular phone. It just rang steadily until it was answered. So then next day, phone rang, same time, I'm in the same place, and he was furious with my secretary. By the time I came out, there were two Army Signal Corps men there saying, I said, what are you doing? He said, we're putting a phone in your bathroom. he'd call you at 5:00 in the morning, and he'd say, this goddamn story about our education task force, what, we got to do something. I'm so just waking up. I felt like saying I never did, believe me. You're the only person in this town that has the New York Times at 5:00 in the morning. Or he'd call because he had Time magazine at 3:00 on Sunday afternoon. I think he drew out of people more than they thought they had, certainly more than I thought I had. But it was endless. I guess the best lesson, I think, I believe this is correct. Most of that staff was young, in their 30s, maybe early 40s, but mid to late 20s and 30s. There was no baby born to any staff member of Lyndon Johnson. My son Mark is here. He was born in 1962, his brother in 64. Then their sister wasn't born till 1970. They were
well, that's a population policy, isn't it?
But he had a tremendous sense that we didn't have enough time. Two senses about time. One, we only had a limited period of time to do something. And two, that once there was light at the end of the tunnel for people that were oppressed, what was acceptable would suddenly become intolerable. And we, no matter how much progress there was, and we had to stay ahead of that.
Let me ask you about the health care reforms. The Kennedy administration tried to pass a Medicare bill, tried to attach it to Social Security legislation, but couldn't get it by. How did Johnson and his team get health care reform done? And how would you assess the Johnson health care reforms a half century later?
Very briefly, in those days, Social Security increases were not geared to inflation. Congress voted every 2 years, just before the elections, to increase Social Security. And I wasn't in the White House then, but in 1964, Johnson got the Medicare bill attached to the Social Security increase on the Senate floor. It went to conference with the House. The House chairman, Wilbur Mills, refused to accept it. Johnson refused to back down and, for the first time ever, killed the Social Security increase. Then he won the landslide election, and he went to Wilbur Mills and said, you know, we got a deal now. And Wilbur Mills had Medicare, he got through both houses. Medicaid came because Mills had passed a bill many years before, a few years before, called the Kerr-Mills bill, Senator Kerr and Wilbur Mills, which provided health care for poor old people, including things like wooden teeth. And he thought that this would help all poor people in the South, but in fact, the big states, New York, Michigan, Pennsylvania, California, got the bulk of those funds. So Johnson said to Mills, you know, basically they're screwing you, those states. They're screwing you. Now, if you had a program that was provided health care based on who's on welfare, and who's medically indigent, you'd get your fair share. And he did that, Mills, let Mills call it his bill. Mills called Medicare his bill. We gave in. I do know that Johnson let doctors set their own fees and let hospitals be reimbursed on a cost-plus basis. That was the price of passing Medicare. And of course, it's been very expensive. But we've never had a health bill of major proportions where you haven't had to give like that. And the other two examples I'd give you are one, George Bush's drug bill, covering drug. He had to let the pharmaceutical companies not compete. That's the only way he got it through. The one thing Johnson insisted on, and one of Obama's major mistakes, he insisted that there be half the Republicans on Medicare and Medicaid. Vote for it. And he said, if not, the Republican governors will kill us. They'll kill us in the appropriations committees, and what he used to call their fellow travelers in the corporations will be a problem. It's not a self-executing bill. This is complicated. We got to have everybody aboard. And he gave stuff to get half the Republicans. And a part of, you can see with Obamacare, Not a single Republican vote, and the price that's being paid now. You know, there are no appropriations for long-term care. There are no appropriations for a whole host of things they can't get. He's had to postpone. And this is an insurance company bill, incidentally. I'm sure those of you in the healthcare field know it. The insurance company's going to make a fortune with this bill, and that was the way they got it passed.
Just fast-forwarding quickly, if Obama had called you, I assume he didn't, and asked your advice about health care reform at the beginning of his administration, well, what would you have told him?
I don't know. You know, I don't know what the politics really were down there. I mean, obviously, we should have just expanded Medicare and had a single payer. I mean, that, you know, it's interesting, and I think it's a function of where the political power in many ways is. We tried in the Johnson years to pass something we call kiddie care, which was to cover people from the moment of conception until the sixth year of life, the mother and during conception and then the child to the sixth year of life, under Medicare. And we couldn't get it passed. George Bush the first, incidentally, tried to do that, and he couldn't get it passed. It's just, there's no lobby out there for little kids the way there is for senior citizens. I think that's the number one. And number two, whatever it would have cost him to get some Republican votes on that.
Coming back to the Great Society Beyond Health, as we're at the 50th anniversary of most of the Great Society legislation, and we're going to have a conference here at Roosevelt House that you're helping us plan next year, or the fall, I guess. Looking back at the Great Society, education, any poverty, urban development, the environment, the arts, all the things that were done, which met your expectations, which fell short, what were some of the unintended consequences?
I think the civil rights legislation, by and large, has met expectations in the sense that we're a different country. And I include in the civil rights legislation the Immigration Reform Act, which opened up Africa and Asia and South America and Southern Europe, the Italians and the Eastern European Jews, to get into this country. Remember, there was a national quota system before then. All you have to do is look at the country, and you can see that may, among other things, be one of the most profound impacts of the Great Society and Lyndon Johnson, where this country looks today. I think I won't say that the narrow anti-poverty program was much more complex than we realized. But you have to understand something else. I think what was going on there, the big machines, the political machines, talking about community action now, were not responsive to the people that were living in the cities. The people that needed those big machines were now largely black, probably some Hispanics, Mexicans maybe, the concept of community action was in fact to blow up the big machines. And it did. Now, what it left in their wake, I don't know. It's not clear yet. I think higher education, the grants and loans and work study program, we thought about putting some incentives or penalties to increase efficiency, Jennifer, in higher education, and we didn't do it because we thought we needed it. Was people forget it was a very controversial bill. The higher education bill was a controversial bill. We only passed it by about 20 votes in the House, and we needed higher education with us, and we didn't want to get into a academic freedom issue. But one of the problems of that bill has been that those grants just keep rising because they're a percentage of whatever the tuition is, and they keep and so there was no incentive for universities to be efficient. A Head Start grew so fast, turned out to be so incredibly popular. Imagine we're talking about preschool education now. I mean, preschool, when Johnson proposed Head Start, Barry Goldwater said it was the Sovietation of American youth. It would be the Sovietation of American children. And he went out into the press room and he said, you know, we have this charge, but he said, you know, he didn't understand it because rich people always had preschool education for their kids. Why couldn't poor people have preschool education? But the program grew so fast, we lost total quality control. And as a lot of you know, it became a babysitting operation coming back. I think, Johnson articulated the concept of affirmative action in his speech at Howard University, in which he said, you can't have two men racing, one who's been in chains for 20 years and the other one who's been in training, and put them at the starting line and say it's a fair race. And I believe in his head, and I think in a lot of our heads on the staff at that point, we viewed that as a one-shot thing, something that might go on for a generation, then done. And now, and believe me, it was a program aimed at blacks. That's who it was for. There was no thought of the extent to which it's become a complex program and created a lot of resentment among young people in this country to this day. So I think that's a mixed bag. It worked.
Mm-hmm.
It certainly worked for what we were trying to get done.
I think it's interesting as you speak about the unintended consequences. You named several there, and that'll be one of the centerpieces of our conference coming up. We're going to open it up to the audience in just a few minutes, but I want to talk a little bit about HEW and Jimmy Carter. About Carter, you wrote the following: in the struggles over welfare reform and national health insurance, I came to realize that I was point man for a president who did not understand the multicolored threads of power inside the Beltway, and neither liked nor respected legislatures, newspeople, or lobbyists who enjoyed and found satisfaction wearing those threads. How do you respond to the Carter-Obama comparisons that we're hearing?
Well, I don't know Obama. I mean, I think President Carter did not. He really did think there was a lot of corrupt. The guys in the Congress were by and large corrupt. My sense from a distance is that Obama sort of feels the same way. I mean, those of you that know Washington know that he has few friends, even among the Democratic leaders in the House and the Senate. I'm not talking about Harry Reid, although I'm sure there are issues with Harry Reid, but with the committee chairman and what have you. Max Baucus, who just left to become ambassador to China, chairman of the Senate Finance Committee, the most powerful committee in the Senate. And about 3 years ago, my wife and I were in Washington. I saw Max, and I said, how's your relationship with President Obama? He said, I have none. He said, I've spent 10 minutes with him. 3 years, 10 minutes with the chairman of the Senate Finance Committee. That's not the way to get anything done in the Senate. I think they did share that. I think they didn't like it. Carter had a sense of, and I'm not putting him down because he was a man of integrity in my judgment and character. But to give you an example, we were going to contain health care. Don't believe the movie on hospital health care costs. We never contained them, but. We were going to allow hospital cost bills to go up only 1.5 times inflation. We had a bill to mandate that. Rostenkowski was the chairman of the health subcommittee in the House. We had to get it out of there. And Rostenkowski wanted to appoint a person that was essentially incompetent to be the HEW director of the region that led out of Chicago, out of which $25 billion poured every year. And after a long back and forth, I finally made a deal with Rostenkowski that I would appoint this person if he served only for a year, cut ribbons, and I'd put a Wilbur Cohen son, who was quite competent, to be the number two guy, and he would run the place. Rostenkowski agreed, but you had to clear regional directors with the White House. So I was clearing this, and Carter didn't want to make the appointment, so I went over to see him, and I explained this to him, and he said, I'm sick of these guys. It's immoral. I said, well, you know, if we don't put this guy in this job, we don't get hospital cost containment. We will get it. We're right. And he's wrong. I said, it will never come out of that subcommittee. And he wouldn't appoint him. I couldn't tell Rosenkowski that was the president. So I told him that I changed my mind. It took me over a year to get back in speaking terms with Rosenkowski. And there was a big element of that with President Carter. On the other example, hot button issue, abortion. Both he and I were opposed to federal funding of abortions under Medicaid. And this was these were the days of the Hyde Amendment, when it was going to pass or not pass. And ultimately, Congress passed the amendment which said, allowed when the life of the mother's at stake, which everybody agreed to, in cases of rape or incest, promptly reported was the term in the bill. So the question is, what do I do? Well, what's proper reporting? We went out and did a survey, and we found out, remember this, 1977. In those days, women did not report being raped, rape or incest, unless they thought they were pregnant. Some enormously high percentage, like over 80, 85%. It was, I guess, such an embarrassing thing and what have you. So I put 60 days as proper reporting. As you might expect, all hell broke loose. From the Catholic bishops, but also from President Carter, who got me on the phone and at length talked to me, literally about the Bible and what, you know, you just can't do this. It's a terrible thing. So, you know, ultimately, I sent a letter to the Congress and said, if you want to change it, change the law. But this is the regulation, and they didn't change the law.
So last question before we open it up. Looking back, well, first of all, I don't think you can say what McNamara said, which was he wasn't sure whether he resigned or he was fired. I think you...
I was fired.
You were fired. But looking back on your time as ATW Secretary, and we saw some of the accomplishments up there, looking back on it, what are you proudest of, and what's your biggest disappointment?
I'm probably proudest of hanging tough on tobacco, and then in a sense also, I mean, a lot of people have quit smoking, but we still have, there's still so much to do. It's a relentless battle. I think the biggest mistake was actually, you know, you forget about how important these decisions are. The issue was, when Carter became president, do we go for welfare reform or national health? And in the campaign, welfare reform had become a big issue. And so we all decided, and he did, and I did, certainly was part of that decision, we'll go for welfare reform. And we ultimately couldn't get it passed. And I always thought that if we, and then when we came up with our national health plan, Teddy Kennedy had his, they were both fighting to be president, and healthcare for the Democratic unity on that project, it was just trampled in the race to be the presidential nominee. I believe to this day that if we had gone with health care reform first, with national health, or the modified program we had proposed, which was expand Medicare and place a mandate on large employers and gradually bring it down over about 20 years to small employers, we could have gotten it passed, but we picked the wrong thing. I think that happens a lot in politics, and I think it's a lesson for the future, because I think what becomes the campaign issue between the media and getting the votes and assembling enough electoral votes to get elected may not be what you really have a chance to get done in that first burst. And the other thing was, I think I moved fast. I wish President Carter had moved fast. I don't think he I don't think anyone in that office has understood how important time was the way Lyndon Johnson did, and my hunch is FDR did in that first 100 days. I mean, you just go full blast, and you're spending your political capital every day, and you're not getting much of it back.
So imagine, and this really is my last question, that Barack Obama calls you down to the White House and says, welcome home, you know this place. I've got some problems. My approval ratings are down. It's been hard to get things done. I'm in my last term. I want to do something. What advice can you give me? What should I do that I'm not doing?
I don't know if he's doing it the right way, but I think his only chance is to get a Democratic House. And I think that chance is slim. I think he should have a plan B, which is how he would work with a House that's not Democratic. It's hard for me. I really have no sense. Washington is such a different place. You know, it's a really different place. And the biggest difference is not partisanship, it's money. It is hard to understand what money has done to Washington. You can look at the map and you can see that there are four of the five richest counties now. I mean, Greenwich is no longer, Fairfield County is no longer up there where it used to be. They're right there. And look at what's happening in the District of Columbia. It's not only being gentrified. I mean, the blacks are being driven into Montgomery County, and those areas are, huge high-rises. They still have the ceiling of 12 stories, whatever. But money has dramatically changed Washington. I remember several years ago, a senator who will remain nameless told me that $5,000 or $10,000 could essentially get you veto power in a subcommittee or get you some little provision. The other thing we know, to get appointments with members of Congress now. I mean, all the law firms, I think, now down there all have their own PACs, they make contributions. It's a very, very different place in that regard. And, I don't know how, I can mention it, and it's great because Johnson proposed public financing of congressional and presidential campaigns. That's how we got the dollar check off. We got nowhere. We made a terrible mistake. That's another big mistake. We could have passed public financing in the Senate in 1966. And we didn't do it because we wanted to get it in the House as well. And we couldn't get it in the House because there were, in those days, about 130 or 140 House members who had no opposition. And there was enough of them to kill any public financing bill. Now there'd be no hope of public financing.
Let's open it up and get your questions. And two requests, we have your name, and please make it short and a question. We'll start right over here. This young man, Mike is coming.
Hi, my name is Abraham Goodman. I'm a student here at Hunter College. First of all, thank you very much for the very inspiring talk. And you mentioned that civil rights legislation, not only the acts mattered, but it changed America. And in the last few years, there was a lot of debate in New York City about public health legislation, tobacco 21, soda portion cap. Do you feel like the debate changed in America since you were in office? And do you feel like, what can be the moment that will change the discourse about public health in America? Like civil rights change the discourse about
public health in
thank you.
And I'm not sure I understand the question fully. I mean, civil rights, I think we're way beyond where we were in the 60s with whatever problems we have. It's still far from perfect, but we don't have a world in which, in which people went to separate restaurants, separate everything, and in which it was, you know, the thought of that there could be a Ken Chenault could ever happen, the African-American chairman of American Express, or an Ursula Burns at Xerox, it was inconceivable.
So how in public health can the discourse be changed now, I think? And how, for example, could you move more to prevention?
Oh, all right. Yeah. That, Robert, I want to enter one thing. This man, Robert Schnaker, is the author of the play All the Way, which opens in March, but which started with Bryan Cranston starring as LBJ. He's worked on it for 5 years. Pulitzer Prize winner on an earlier play. And I'm so touched that you're here tonight.
And the only reason I'm leaving is I have a preview performance tonight.
Good.
The only thing that would take me away from Joe Calhoun.
So it opens
March
6th.
Previews now.
Previews
and,
now.
And part two is The Great Society. And that opens this July. And I'll be spending a lot more time, hopefully, with Mr. Goddard.
All right.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to.
Yeah.
Good luck. Public health, prevention, okay? Very tough. There's no profit in prevention. My own view is we have to, there's plenty of profit in treatment and care and pharmaceuticals. We have to make it, we have to both provide incentives and penalties relating to conduct. Simple example, Medicare provides free vaccinations for pneumonia and free vaccinations for the flu. If a Medicare eligible person doesn't get those vaccinations and they get pneumonia or the flu, and we said you got to pay the bill then, believe me, we have 100%. I don't know what the percentages are now. I actually suggested this when I was secretary, and you would have thought I was going to hang the old people out to dry because there was a congressman named Claude Pepper that was appalled at that thought. But I think we need I think we need more of that. We are seeing I have a sense that the vast education on food and what people eat and what have you is having an impact in this country. It's remarkable how fast people can adjust. I mean, the most recent adjustment to me is Coca-Cola. You can now look on television and you can see aggressive advertising. Coke Zero. Zero calories. Coca-Cola, whatever it is, 70 calories or 80 calories. But I mean, we're now seeing this kind of advertising in all kinds of stuff. And you know, that's the plus of the system. When people start to indicate that this may be important to them, the large corporations can get pretty agile about advertising and moving on that stuff.
Tom Farley, who was Mayor Bloomberg's health commissioner, is now a Tisch Fellow here at Roosevelt House, and we'll be having some programs coming up on the whole question of prevention and behavior change. Over here. Microphone coming.
Thank you. My name is Bill Blakemore. Given your experience taking on the big tobacco companies, your thoughts on the rapidly accelerating crisis of man-made global warming, which is becoming more and more visible this summer especially, which a number of investigative journalists and academics have said has been prevented from having serious federal legislation by disinformation intimidation campaigns paid for by fossil fuels, according to a lot of reporting. What is your perspective on any prospects for something meaningful from Washington, which the world is looking to for leadership on man-made global warming and the crisis?
Well, I'm not an environmental expert by a long shot. I mean, I think the politics of that really require focused presidential leadership. Somebody's got to make it a big issue for themselves, and an energy secretary or an interior secretary or both, in which the president says, We're gonna educate this country. We're gonna go after this, because the money is, I think you were indicating, is on the other side right now. But I notice, maybe I'm wrong. I mean, there's more and more, more and more solar energy going into homes. Somehow, some of that must be coming profitable. Or maybe I just see it on the Connecticut Gold Coast. I don't know. Maybe there are more.
Got some questions over here, gentlemen. Right there with the red tie.
Well, when you were secretary, I ran your New York office there at Medicare and Medicaid. And one of the things I worked closely with you on was to keep the troubled hospitals out. The hospitals that were in trouble financially, Brooklyn Jewish, you may remember, and all the other financially troubled hospitals, to keep them open, and we did. As a matter of fact, we got a policy out of you to really pay attention to those hospitals. Getting to my question, I spent 31 years in HEW, and you were the only, I worked for 7 secretaries, you were the only one who came to that department who gave us great hope, because you're the only one who knew what we were about. You're the only one from the very first day you got there. I think you brought in 17, 18 people, and you started running. And I was just wondering, with all of that knowledge and understanding of our department and the political skills you had, looking back, is there anything you wish you had done that you didn't do? And I'm thinking particularly about the Moynihan study that never really saw the light of day, about the black family being destroyed by slavery. But you did so much more. I just wonder if you had thoughts about what you didn't do.
Well, you know, I wish, sure. I think the Moynihan study, and Johnson did give it some attention in the speech at Howard University in 65, which was devoted in large measure to the family. We did, the one thing I guess we did do was, it was considered inappropriate when I arrived at HEW, these odd things happen, to go after deadbeat fathers. There was a bill, there was a law that Russell Long had gotten passed that authorized the department to do that and get you may recall that. And I really energized that law. Russell Long loved it, but I got all hell from the liberals. I never understood that. I think I wish we had worked harder on that. I mean, my own, because I think it's the black family, the poor black family. It's not simply the single parent, but the family is to me as big a problem with education as the education system in this city. We need stronger families. We need families that'll tell the kids you got to learn, you got to study, you got to do your homework, and to have that happen, we need hope. We need to show that there's hope for those kids. You know, you mentioned the family thing. I will say, just going back to Johnson. He used to say, look at what we've done in our country to the black family. We brought them over as slaves. We separated them, traded them. We had a civil war. Then a lot of the men came north to make enough money to pay for the South. They had wives or something down south, so they didn't get married when they came here. We then passed a welfare law that said you can only get welfare for your children if there's no man in the house. I don't know if any of you recall that.
Yeah.
And with all Johnson's power, incidentally, we couldn't get that changed. We tried to get that changed and to provide child care and job training for mothers, and it was just ran into a total brick wall on the Hill. So I think we could have done a hell of a lot more on that score. You're right.
Two final questions. A young lady in the back there.
Hi, I'm Suzanne Sherbeck. I'm a writer. I have read the Robert Caro books on Lyndon Johnson.
Right.
And I wondered if you have and what you thought of them.
I've read the books. I think Caro's, and I've spent some time with Caro recently, but I've read all of his books. I think they vary. They show the evolution of Johnson for sure. He spoke actually at the conference Jonathan yep. mentioned earlier. I think in this last book, he shows how, as he says, there wouldn't be a Civil Rights Act if Lyndon Johnson hadn't been president. What comes out, and I'm sure he's going to kill him on the war in this last volume and probably praise him on the Great Society, but I think you see in the first volume a real sense of what it was, it's hard to imagine. When Lyndon Johnson was elected to Congress in 1938, there was no running water and there was no electricity in the Hill Country. I mean, just think about that. So that's what he grew up in. And Caro uses that very effectively. I think Caro's done a very good job. I'm not adoring Lyndon Johnson. I mean, this is the most complicated, difficult. McNamara said to me when I told that story, McNamara said, "This will be the most intelligent person you'll ever work for." And I said, "No, Bob, you are the most intelligent person I've ever worked for." He said, "No, you can't imagine." And believe me, it was I can tell you that every night, almost, he would take a stack of papers like this, maybe make 60 or 70 decisions, read them, check approve, disapprove, or see me. It was rare that you didn't get an answer back when I'd send in a memo on Monday that I didn't have an answer Tuesday morning, cold as night reading, in addition to everything else. But I think he was, God knows he was haunted by the Kennedys. And in the last volume, you can see how nasty, real son of a bitch Robert Kennedy was to him. Really comes through in that. But there'll be more books written about him, I think. I'm talking about hundreds of books before it's all over. Caro, there are four or five people down there writing biographies or pieces of him now. I think Caro wants to be the chronicler of Lyndon Johnson, and we'll see.
Joe, you've done a lot in your life. What grabs your interest, excites your passion now? What more do you want to accomplish?
I mean,
make that the last question.
I want to make my wife happy, but and that should be my passion. But I do think I will. I can't resist. We happen to see Philip Seymour Hoffman's problem, and certainly living in the city. But just think about the fact that we now know that smoking cigarettes, smoking pot, drinking alcohol, using drugs, all affect the brain in similar ways, something we didn't know. And I can tell you from all the work we've done at the Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse, talk about healthcare costs. A third of healthcare costs are attributable to smoking, excessive drinking, and drug use. And we still don't deal with it in this country. We still don't deal with it. And my mini passion is, I think the media has done the worst reporting on marijuana on any subject I can imagine. If you talk to people in the medical field, they will tell you that we are talking about a drug that is at least 10 times stronger than it was a generation ago, that is an addictive drug, that sparks latent psychosis and schizophrenia. And if you talk to people, and counselors that treat kids, they will tell you virtually every kid that's hooked on something serious started with alcohol and marijuana. So those are my many passions.
What about your president?
This is Mrs. Califano asking.
My wife is not a good Democrat.
Democrat.
I know that.
We're going to give.
I will say the president, that was an appalling thing. It reflected a level of ignorance that was incredible. In that, she's talking about the New Yorker review in which the president says, "It's like smoking a cigarette." It isn't like smoking a cigarette. It is in some ways, but it's not really like smoking a cigarette. Either he, I don't know the answer to this, either he was very ill-prepared for that interview and a couple of other things he said in it, or he was just, it was part of a, you know, continuing dramatic appeal to get young people out there for this election coming up.
So on behalf of all of us, Joe, it is a great blessing and a privilege to have you as part of the Hunter family. And as a point of personal privilege, I would like to say thank you again. I was actually an intern for Joe Califano when it was still okay to be a Washington intern. And much of what I learned about the power of public policy was working at H&W and remembering your real just advocacy for policy to change lives. And it was truly an extraordinary time. And Jonathan, every time you do these series, I realize how grateful we are to have you as a leader at Roosevelt House and how challenged we will be to find the right person to sit with you to do an interview of interesting people I have known. So, thank you all so much for being with us tonight and a wonderful hand for these incredible men.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.